We pair AI methods with physics simulation methods. We use the physics simulation methods to synthesize new data. We also use a different sort of AI called active learning to help us get the most out of our next data point that we bother to spend the computational resources on synthesizing.
There's been a lot of speculation about how fault-tolerant quantum computing might accelerate the power of artificial intelligence in the future. But what if those technologies switched roles? What if I told you that AI is already improving certain aspects of current quantum technology? Find out how businesses and verticals can start to use these techniques for real use cases in quantum sensing, simulation, and migration to post-quantum cryptography in this episode of The Post-Quantum World. I'm your host, Konstantinos Karagiannis. I lead quantum computing services at Protiviti, where we're helping companies prepare for the benefits and threats of this exploding field. I hope you'll join each episode as we explore the technology and business impacts of this post-quantum era. Our guest today is the Technical Director, Global Public Sector at SandboxAQ, Paul Kassebaum. Welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks very much for having me.
Yeah, I figured we'd dive right in and captivate the audience. Let's focus for a second on the AQ and the company name. How does SandboxAQ bring together the worlds of AI and quantum?
Yeah, sure. So for engineers, a sandbox, it represents a place that's safe to explore and not have to worry about breaking things as you're investigating. And the A in AQ stands for artificial intelligence. And the Q stands for quantum information sciences and technologies. Currently, I'd say that the AI in our name is the key enabler for many of the quantum technologies. This is especially true for our sensing division. Let me zoom out a bit. We focus on three different application or technical verticals: cryptography management, which is a subsection of quantum communications, quantum sensing, and quantum simulation. The AI is especially important for our quantum sensing technical verticals. So within that technical vertical of sensing, we have two engineering teams currently focused on different applications. One is focusing on using quantum sensors to detect very, very small variations in the Earth's gravitational field as a way to get an absolute idea of where you are, latitude, longitude, and altitude on the Earth. And so we're taking quantum sensors that have been demonstrated in laboratory environments and putting them on extremely magnetically noisy aircraft, right? So we have to disambiguate, using AI, to disambiguate the magnetic fields coming from the different electronic components on the airplane versus the Earth's magnetic field. The other application team in that technical vertical of quantum sensing is focused on, again, sensing magnetic field, but this time of your heart. The electricity that's driving the rhythm of your heart generates a magnetic field, and it's an extremely weak field, and the variations of it are also very weak. And there the challenge using AI is to disambiguate your heart's magnetic field from all of the electronics in a hospital environment. Unlike a MRI machine, which will have a dedicated room that's meant to be a very magnetically quiet space, our device is designed to work in emergency rooms, which comes with all of the magnetic noise of the environment of an emergency room without any sort of magnetic shield around you or the device. Instead, we're picking apart the signal from the noise using AI.
That makes a lot of sense. And we are going to dive into all the different offerings. So it's fair to say that AI enables you to get the best data out of any of the solutions, really, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Okay, makes great sense. And how did all this evolve from Google's parent, Alphabet?
Yeah, so I joined after the company spun out of that parent. So I don't have direct firsthand experience from that. But what I've been told, is that Sergey Brin, one of the founders of Google, had wanted to create or incubate a startup that would focus on quantum technologies that can work in the near term as opposed to quantum computers, which will work in the long term eventually. And he pulled in the current CEO of SandboxAQ, Jack Hittery, to help incubate this idea to form a company within Alphabet, and that it was incubated within Alphabet for about 5 years before it spun out.
Oh, wow. That's deep, deep incubation.
Yeah, that's my understanding. And they just threw a bunch of ideas on the whiteboard for a number of years, trying to get at, well, great, but this technology, will it work in the short term or the long term? And it's a head scratcher case by case. So when it came out of Alphabet, the ideas that were being pursued were cryptographic management being motivated by the inevitability of quantum computers and different sorts of risks to the confidentiality today, integrity of your messages and authentication into your systems once quantum computers are real. So we're aiding the migration to what's called post-quantum cryptography, new algorithms for encryption that work on today's computers and secure today's communications from being decrypted in the future, scooped up today, decrypted in the future by quantum computers. Also help you migrate your cryptography systems that help enable keeping the integrity of your messages and authentication of your systems. You know, this user really is who they say they are, accelerating your ability to make those systems quantum resistant before quantum computers become real. And those are at risk once quantum computers are real and people are faking their identities with quantum computers in the future. That's our quantum communications side. That came out of the gate right away from Alphabet. Mm-hmm. Another thing that came out of the gate was the magnetic navigation team and the magnetic cardiography team, those two quantum sensing applications I mentioned earlier, as well as a team dedicated to using today's high-performance computers to simulate physical systems that are governed by quantum physics, for example, medicines and materials.
I was going to ask you about that next, actually. Yeah, like this whole idea of AI merging with quantum, I figured it must play pretty strongly in your simulation and optimization solution.
Yes, absolutely.
So I don't know if you want to. Yeah, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that, because I know a lot of people when they hear SandboxAQ, they probably do think of the PQC context.
Yeah,
and we will dive into that in a moment. But yeah, basically, if you could let us know like the kinds of use cases.
Yeah, that you're thank you. Technology. Absolutely. AI is extremely important for our simulation vertical as well. The audience, you may have heard of projects like AlphaFold that came out of Google DeepMind, using today's big HPC high-performance computers to predict the structure of how proteins fold. Mm-hmm. It turns out that these AI models are very hard to use beyond their training set. Unfortunately, that's sort of like that's kind of the whole point of AI, is you train it and then it can deal with things it hasn't seen before. Unfortunately, that hasn't rung true in the drug discovery space. Most AI systems don't generalize very well. And so what we do at SandboxAQ is we pair AI methods with physics simulation methods. We use the physics simulation methods to synthesize new data. We can trust the computational results to treat them as if they were experimental data, to expand the training set of AI systems. And so wherever we want to push the boundary of what an AI can extrapolate beyond its training set, we add to the training set using physics simulations. And we've developed techniques that allow us to take advantage of massive clusters of GPUs available through cloud service providers and efficiently do those physics simulations. And then we also use a different sort of AI called active learning to help us get the most out of our next data point that we bother to spend the computational resources on synthesizing. In other words, active learning helps you figure out what's the piece of information that I'm currently missing that would give my machine learning system the greatest learning improvement. And so is this data unique? Like, is this data telling my AI system it doesn't already know?
Yeah, so this might be a bit of a stretch, but there's always been this idea of hybrid, right? Where you're doing some things classical, some things quantum. Is any of this approach gonna allow us to maybe get something closer to like an advantage by filling in gaps or, you know, helping along like what we can actually accomplish with these qubits that are still, you know, a little more fragile.
Currently, the bulk of our work is focused on algorithms that work on today's computers.
Okay.
Right. We recently acquired a company called Good Chemistry out of Vancouver, Canada. And they, along with that acquisition, we did take on a few folks who do focus on quantum algorithms that only work on quantum computers. And we're happy to have them on board. We're trying to figure out a near-term use case for those engineers and researchers. So the bulk of the team is focused on what can we do on today's massive clusters of GPUs. And we have a small team that we acquired recently. We're trying to look at way we might leapfrog once quantum computers become more capable.
I can imagine that being linked up with Google doesn't hurt when it comes to needing some extra horsepower and running.
Yeah, absolutely. But curiously, one of the reasons Jack Hittery insisted on Alphabet spinning out SandboxAQ is to allow us to choose a cloud service provider we need for each use case. Since we're not part of Alphabet anymore, we don't have incentives to only play with GCP, Google Cloud Provider. We do work with AWS, Azure, and GCP.
Oh, great. Wow. Yeah, that does sound pretty liberating. with Security Suite, that's starting to generate a little buzz in the PQC world. Mm-hmm. You want to tell our listeners a little bit about that offering?
Yeah, sure. So the Security Suite is, the vision for it is a way to a new way to manage your cryptography in an organization so that you have a situational awareness of what the state of your cryptography is at any given point, if there are any sort of policy violations of your cryptography, and if there are, also a system to easily deploy new cryptography, make changes to your cryptography. It's very rarely the case that a cryptographic vulnerability is isolated to swapping out a single file. It's much more likely to be a big, hairy Gordian knot of things happening on your network communications, things happening on your file systems and hosts, or things happening in the way that your software developers have implemented cryptography in the source code that your organization owns, in some combination of those three typical ways that lenses you would have into the cryptography of your organization.
You have the ability to have like a control center sort of view, right? Mm-hmm. And then also a way to remediate. So if you could dig a little bit into what that looks like.
Yeah. So currently there are executive orders, office management budget memos, guidance from groups like NIST and NSA and CISA for different government agencies to start their migration to post-quantum cryptography. And the first step that everyone is trying to get their heads around is just cryptographic inventorying. And through our control center, it provides a high-level overview of what our soft security suite has found, you know, what types of keys are discovered, what were the encryption methods. And so you can have maybe the CISO have a high-level overview of what's going on, but then your security officers who have to actually roll up their sleeves and get into the muck, they can dive down, drill down, and see, for example, track how a key is generated and used across these different lenses that I mentioned, network communications, file hosts, and applications. And then, as I said earlier, it's not just about understanding the state of play of your cryptography, but also rolling out changes to it. And that's, in other words, remediation. Once you find problems, how do you remediate them? The current state of our product, again, the Security Suite, is we give advice for how to do those remediations manually and how to automatically get the work into your ticketing systems like Jira. We've designed it assuming that the end users are not themselves cryptographers or cryptanalysts. So when we find a policy violation, we also give best practices, suggestions for how to remediate these. But currently the current status is the product relies on the engineer to do the remediation manually. The vision is that we're going to be able to automate that process.
And so far, remediation can't really be done, right? Like the general guidance has been from like the NSM-10 document that you shouldn't try to implement post-quantum ciphers until NIST publishes its standards. Yeah. So I guess what's being done right now is maybe remediating things that are just wrong to begin with, like you're running SSL2 or something like that, right? Yeah. So you know it works because of things like that.
Yeah, it depends on who we're talking to. You know, most of our customers in the private sector will just care about the last migration that they're still in, right? Like you said, maybe it's just TSL 1.2 to 1.3 is what they're concerned about or what have you. God forbid, even SHA-1 or something. And so, but many of our government customers are concerned about the quantum threat. They are concerned about getting PQC into their systems. But because these haven't been standardized, right, there's some advice from the NSA to use the crystals, key encapsulation method and digital signature. But standardization process from this goes on. So what our customers who do care about PQC migration, but also are concerned about maintaining regulatory compliance with like FIPS and PCI, DSS, they'll reach for hybrid algorithms to try to get the best of both worlds while NIST is still standardizing the algorithms and updating the compliance requirements like the upcoming FIPS 233, I think it is, that's pens down currently, but still in process.
Sure. Inventory was due for federal agencies like a year and a half ago. So have you already gotten a bunch of feedback from customers about how that's going?
Yeah, so they're like, so CISA, for example, has to receive all of these reports. And so they're sitting on top of a mountain of spreadsheets of various formats and various interpretations of what this entailed. And I'm sure the majority of them, I'd imagine, rely on self-attestation. You know, trust me. CISA has got, like, it all boils up to them, so they have a huge headache. But then the individual agencies that have reported to CISA have spoken with us and said, I'd like to try to confirm this self-attestation and as the requirements of what this reporting really entails and the frequency of it gets more demanding, we're looking for ways to automate this. And that's what we provide.
And have you gotten any inside info on how the NIST process is going? I mean, I feel like, will it be July like everything else has been? Like, is that your best guess right now?
I don't know, actually.
I don't know. I figured if you heard anything buzzing. That's the only guess I can make, really.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Surprises happen, you know.
So I guess
we'll surprised by Rainbow and Psyche. Who knows what will happen?
We talk a lot about crypto agility, but if you're an actual coder, the person, you know, like the boot on the ground there, there's a lot of complexity in actually implementing it. So this brings us, I guess, to Sandwich.
Yes.
And how does it help keep developers from adding to the problem, you know, and letting them actually fix it?
Yeah, I was just able to sit on a PQC roundtable organized by OMB. And one of the comments that was made that the whole room was shaking their heads up and down to was, we need to start creating standard APIs for software developers to implement common cryptographic patterns and stop giving, stop having them like only have the option of having enough levers and rope to hang themselves by. So SandboxAQ's first approach to give a high level cryptographic library that tries to provide one of the many aspects of what that proposed hypothetical API would be for software engineers to quickly and easily create, for example, secure tunnels and things like that. So we have a bunch of documentation on our GitHub page and tutorials that walk a developer through common use cases. It's an open source project, so we're always happy to get new contributors as well.
Yeah, and it has a very AI image generated look to the logo.
we have a blog called Crypto Cafe, and we decided early on that all of the images are gonna, for the blog posts or the header images, the hero images, are all AI generated.
Yeah, it's got this like AI watercolor look to the sandwich. It works. So shifting back to quantum sensing, we talked a little earlier. I get the idea of like taking AI and working with all that data because it could be a lot. And so I'm assuming there's no hardware development. You guys don't actually touch the sensing side from there, right? You don't do anything in hardware.
Yeah, we do. We have hardware engineers on our sensing teams. And we have the expertise to create the so-called tip, I like to call tip of the spear of these sensing systems. Mm-hmm. But we typically don't do that. Instead, we focus on system engineering. So we'll take off-the-shelf quantum sensors that were built for some intended purpose, actually not the intended purposes we're designing around. Mm-hmm. And then we'll build the electronics and the software and sometimes the mechanical structure for the medical, for the MCG device. We have a armature, basically, to get the array of sensors over your chest while you're still laying in a gurney. So we did all the mechanical design for that system. Yeah, so the sensing team is a very physical, hands-on.
Oh, wow. So there's like a level of quantum breadboarding going on there.
Yeah, for sure. And so like we're a distributed team except for our sensing teams. They have like the one legit office in Palo Alto because they need to build stuff physically.
Yeah, yeah. Let me mail you this little chip I just put together, solder it in place and tell me how it works. Right. Yeah, I think that makes sense. And are there any... What would you see as a timeline for sensing right now? Because a lot of people call it the aspect of quantum information science that's here, that's real.
Yeah.
So what do you think for its like mass adoption? How soon do you think?
Yeah, both of our teams, the magnetic navigation team and the magnetocardiography team, there are certain hurdles to their timelines that are not exactly technological, actually. They're more regulatory. So for commercial flights, you know, we need FAA regulatory approval. The militaries have their own regulatory constraints and or criteria. And for medical instruments, we have to get through FDA clinical trials. So the magnetic navigation system is going to take us, both of them really, on the order of 5 years probably, before they're really being relied on. Right now, they're both in different sorts of test modes. So our magnetic navigation team has racked up about 100 hours of test flight data. So mm-hmm. The physical box that our engineers built has been on different vessels, total cumulative of 100 hours. But it's self-contained right now. It's not plugged into the system, and it's certainly not relied on for real-time navigation. And then, so that'll probably take about 5 years before it can actually be relied on as a backup to GPS. And our MCG device is in three hospitals right now collecting observational data. So we have volunteers whose hearts we're scanning with our system, non-invasively, passively. And we have medical staff engaged with our teams, but this is, it's just collecting observational data. No diagnoses are being made based off of this.
Yeah. They can't put a patient at risk because you're not making a decision based on that.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So yeah. Because they're both highly regulated application areas, it's probably going to take about 5 years, even though in a sense it works. Mm-hmm. The navigation system is not accurate enough, but it's more accurate than nothing. MCG system, it creates real videos of the magnetic field of your heart, but more studies are required. Clinical trials are required to map the images we're generating to actual diagnoses.
Yeah.
So in a sense, the tech kind of works already, but the application has a lot of other complexities beyond the fundamentals of the tech.
That regulatory aspect must be frustrating. Someone's going to scan a chipmunk next year and claim some kind of quantum advantage. You're going to be like, we were already doing that. That'd be so funny.
Yes.
So you came to Sandbox from IBM,
yeah,
right?
That's true.
Yeah. So tell us a little bit about your quantum journey and what Sandbox is doing to generate like talent.
Thank you for asking. I originally got into a PhD program in physics because I wanted to understand quantum mechanics as best one could. I was really fascinated by the topic. And so originally, quantum to me was the physics of the world, like electrons, how they move and things like that. Then I joined IBM in their quantum computing division. I was super excited to join them because I had never thought about physical quantum systems used to store and manipulate information. I really didn't know what quantum information was before joining IBM. So it was an incredible on-the-job education there. When I left IBM, it was a bittersweet decision because I loved the people. I thought they were doing incredible work, still are. They have a great educational mission that I got to benefit from personally while I worked there. But they have a great team doing education outside the walls of IBM. Like the most popular videos and courses to learn quantum computing for free and open source software, it all comes out of IBM.
Absolutely. The Qiskit community, yeah, the whole thing.
The Qiskit community, absolutely. They're the free tier of their quantum computers on the cloud. Yeah, it's incredible. And so it was, again, bittersweet decision for me to leave IBM. But I joined SandboxAQ because one of the things was really curious to me was that there were all these other lenses to quantum information science I had not considered before. Quantum information for sensing, quantum information as a cryptographic area of study. And then the simulation of quantum systems was something I was familiar with, but I'm not a huge AI expert, which added another interesting complexity to that technical vertical for me personally. And then curiously to me, quantum computing was intentionally not touched by SandboxAQ. They wanted to focus on things that have real impact immediately, today, right now. That was why I wanted to join SandboxAQ. It was just kind of expanding my understanding of quantum phenomena, and the mission is incredible. So I particularly work on a public sector team. So my team, we focus exclusively on governments as the customer. And so it's incredibly important for democratic nations to adopt AQ for the welfare and the defense of their nations. And so I think it's I'm honored to be able to help the U.S. and its allied nations to wrap its head around these technologies, make them real, and make them deployable. The other great aspect of SandboxAQ is the crazy combination of skills under this one organization. We get together pretty regularly, although we're distributed. We'll get together as a total company twice a year. It's one spot. And in my role, I have to do this virtually regularly anyway. So I'm talking to chemists, biologists, geoscientists, cryptographers, cryptanalysts, people who are specialists in massively parallel computing for the simulation team. It's just like a crazy universe of AI and quantum experts all under one roof. It's a wild place to work.
I bet. And now you're learning all these other areas and you're seeing people. Does anyone like cross over, like they're working more on PQC and then they take an interest in more of the AI side or something like that? Do you ever have that going on over there?
Yeah. So I've seen that usually the particular people who come to mind are folks who help with compute infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So I've seen a few folks migrate between sometimes more in more than one direction over the course of a year, back and forth between the cryptography management team and the simulation team. They both are using AI compute infrastructure in different ways. And sometimes those skills are very transferable from team to team.
Yeah, it's always interesting to see how companies do that and handle anything with moving talent around. Mm-hmm. As we're looking for advantage, as we're looking for real world use cases, people tend to wear a lot of hats.
Yes, for sure.
To try and find out what's going to really stick, right, mm-hmm. in the quantum industry. So before I let you go, I've noticed a lot of headlines with SandboxAQ, you know, partnerships and the like. Mm-hmm. But is there anything exciting coming up that maybe you'd want to telegraph or some future plans or roadmaps or anything that you're able to share? You know, more public stuff, obviously not.
Yeah. Well, one thing was recent. I can talk about some recent news that maybe hasn't made waves mm-hmm. yet, but is public technically. So like we recently joined, NIST started a new consortium around AI safety, which I think is incredibly important. This came out of an executive order from the White House charging NIST mm-hmm. with dealing with AI risks that are tangible today, not like what if some generalized super AI comes online 10 years from now, but all the risks that are real and palpable today, and start doing something about it right now. I'm proud that SandboxAQ is among the first group of companies to be involved in this consortium that just got started a couple of days ago.
So probably too early to ask you what you found.
Yeah, for now, it's a little too early. But what I'm hoping we're going to be able to do is help with the security of AI systems. You know, what I've been worried about is if you have access to an AI system that you can ping through a scalable API, you know, that AI had to get trained on some data. So what methods are people trying to use to get access to the underlying data through the AI model that they have direct access to? And if you can do that, you might be violating all sorts of privacy issues. So I'm hoping that our group, among other things, would be able to help advise NIST on how to prevent those sorts of attacks on confidentiality.
Wow. So that and the whole PQC angle, you're going to be interfacing with NIST quite a lot this year, I would say.
Yep.
2024 is going to be a big one for you.
Yes, yes. They need more funding. We don't get any funding through NIST, but the things that they're tasked with are crazy for the size and the budget of this little government agency. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's like just securing the world. That's it. Something small. Yeah. Everyone's going to follow. And if it's not done correctly, everyone's going to follow it right into the ground, right? Like we need to.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it is amazing. Yeah. What's on their shoulders. I get it. Well, thank you so much for joining. This was really great. And maybe we'll get to talk in the future about how that other stuff's going too.
Yeah, I hope so. That'd be great. Thank you.
Now it's time for Coherence, the Quantum Executive Summary, where I take a moment to highlight some of the business impacts we discussed today in case things got too nerdy at times. Let's recap. Sandbox blends AI and quantum technologies, focusing on three technical areas: quantum sensing, quantum simulation, and cryptographic management. In sensing, AI improves precision. For example, AI disambiguates magnetic fields from an airplane's electronics to improve navigational sensing. The same approach could improve medical scanning, separating electrical impulses in a human heart from medical equipment in, say, a busy emergency room. SandboxAQ is involved in all layers of working with off-the-shelf quantum sensors, including system engineering, electronics, software, and mechanics. Quantum simulation use cases feature quantum-inspired algorithms running on classical hardware. The hope with AI is often to train it and then have it provide insights into what it hasn't seen before, provide new knowledge to help the world, etc. SandboxAQ is using physics simulation methods to expand data sets and train AI. Then a different active learning AI is used to try and fill in the gaps. This could theoretically lead to solving real business problems on current hardware. ActiveGuard, that's active with an AQ, provides a comprehensive view of an organization's cryptography and helps the migration to PQC. The suite identifies potential current and future vulnerabilities and suggests remediation strategies, which are done manually for now, but which will be automated in the future. The suite helps businesses balance security with regulatory compliance while standards are still under development this year. And it helps automate cryptographic inventory. For developers who have to implement cryptography on a code level, Sandwich is an easy-to-use API. It's open source, so they'd welcome contributions if you're up for the challenge. That does it for this episode. Thanks to Paul Kassebaum for joining to discuss SandboxAQ. And thank you for listening. If you enjoyed the show, please subscribe to Protiviti's The Post-Quantum World, and maybe leave a review to help others find us. Be sure to follow me on all socials at Constant Hacker. That's Constant with a K, Hacker. You'll find links there to what we're doing in quantum computing services at Protiviti. You can also DM me questions or suggestions for what you'd like to hear on the show. For more information on our quantum services, check out Protiviti.com or follow Protiviti Tech on Twitter and LinkedIn. Until next time, be kind and stay quantum curious.